songs that analytics if you do a movie. The talk I have broken down into three parts. The first part will be talking about the evolution of whatever we did in movie and where we are. The second part will be talking about a particular system which we internally call Yoda to do analytics. And the third one, I want to keep about 15 minutes or so to demo the system, because these kind of talks don't mean so much unless you see what is happening. I'll be taking the questions towards the end, there's a lot of stuff to cover, so we hold off all the questions today. Okay, so when talking to people across the months and years I've been working and also we have always here, I noticed that many of us, or rather most of us, were starting with data. A lot of data go through typically the same phases in the data processing. And we thought it'd be good to share our experiences and what mistakes we did, what worked for us, what didn't work for us, so that you can use some of it to not make those same mistakes and learn at our expense. And we do the same when we talk to others. So this talk is not about, comparing the merits and demerits of what is available and, out there. It's just showing you what worked on the ground for us and what didn't work. So just to give a little bit about the scale of the problem, I know you're seeing a lot of gigabytes and terabytes from yesterday. This is the kind of thing we handle every day. About 3 billion records that come in the system. These records are basically from the ad serving. In mobility, in the business of ad serving, so when they get a request for an ad and they serve, they log it. When a click happens, they are again logging. And you have multiple other life cycles, a conversion could happen. By conversion, I mean a download, or someone could make a payment or something else. So you log all those things. It's roughly about 2.5 terabytes of uncompressed JSON. So, treat that number with a little bit of a pinch of salt, not so much. Not everything what we log is meaningful. There's a lot of junk user agents of a device, who would want to do a lot of analysis if you already extracted the information. But still, it's a lot of data if you want to do anything meaningful. About 100 primary dimensions and 300 derived dimensions. So whenever you are into the field of analysis of data, the second point, which is the number of dimensions and measures, are very, very important. Just saying the raw counts of the record numbers and the size of data doesn't mean much. If all you're doing is just logging it for, regulatory purposes or something, you could just log it and keep archiving it. But the key part is that you would want to query this data very frequently on so many dimensions and measures, and that makes it really hard to organize the data. You have, analysis horizon is one very important aspect of analysis of data. How long a period do you want to go back and do the analysis? If you were to do a daily analysis, probably 3 billion records aggregated with a few million records, probably 10 or 20 million records at most. And we could do analysis on it pretty easily, maybe using a database. But if you have analysis horizon of years and you want to see day by day trend over the entire year, the problem suddenly explodes and becomes slightly unmanageable. So to continue on that, as I said, data sizes and the number of records themselves are not the complete picture. What you do with that data is maybe even more important. For example, if you are into medical sciences or you are into computational biology, even 1 gig of data would probably be a lot of crunching, and would take probably hours of effort to get into meaningful out of it. Whereas if you're in reporting domain this talk is talking about, then 1 gig of data is not so much. Probably you could write a standalone Java application. That's one extreme of it, just to crunch through the data and give it a number. So the data which we get, it becomes even more harder because of these things. First thing is very, very frequently changing dynamicity in the model of the data. When we started off, we were majorly into these feature phones. By feature phone, I mean Nokia kind of phones where you sell ringtones and you let the user download wallpapers. And that was the kind of business model. So actually, the data what we log is a reflection of the business we are in. As the business becomes more complicated, the data which you are logging and how you are modeling also becomes more complicated. So we started off 2-3 years back by serving the ringtone and wallpaper kind of ads. Slowly, the smartphone business crept in, even in this side of the world. iPhone came in, and iPhone actually started becoming popular, came in long before that. It started becoming popular. So you could now serve very different kind of ads. You could serve, actually not 3D, 3D now came now, but you could serve a more bigger banner ad on the phone, or you could even serve slightly interactive ad. So they force you to capture different aspects of the advertisement which you want to analyze. We come to it like towards the end of the presentation, where I actually show what kind of things you could do. Then even the query patterns are not very fixed. So within those 300 or 400 odd dimensions, you don't know what the user or the analyst inside the company wants to query today. The impressions in America went down. I mean, is it a cross-world concept, or is it just focused to America? If it is just America, then is it focused to a particular state or a particular segment of user or some operating system? Or it could be that one of the big advertisers who was burning like hundreds of thousands or million dollar video suddenly went away, so your impressions have gone down. You don't know what you're looking for. So if we, the reason I went into this is because if the query patterns are known, then what you would do is you would create some views out of the data and store it in a very, very efficient read-only data store. It could be as simple as MySQL, Postgres, or you can even get columnar data stores like Infobright or what have you, or even go with things like Cognos or something where you actually have some sense of what the query is going to be looking like. You can't build models for 200, 300 dimensions. We want both canned and ad hoc reports. So there's a big distinction, and the definition of canned report is actually very flaky. So canned reports are something where the user or large amount or large segment of the users in a company want to see on a day-on-day basis without any change. So it could be a campaign manager wants to look at his accounts every day in the morning and see how well they are doing, whether he should be going to them and asking for more data or something is wrong. Ad hoc report is more when you don't know exactly what you're looking for. You have some idea, but then it's more of an exploratory process. What we have noticed is that very, very frequently a query starts from an analysis starts from being ad hoc. People do it over a period of days or something, and then they say this makes sense for me, and then they say crystallize it, materialize it, and I want to see this report every day. I don't want to be doing this every day. So there is no clear distinction between what you can say ad hoc. We definitely know, what you can say can. We definitely know what ad hoc is. Then we have, like I told, we have multiple phase shifted data. By phase shifted, I mean you could have a request coming at this time, let's say in this hour, whatever hour is there, 12th hour of the day. You could have a click coming for it half an hour after that, and then you could have a like an app being downloaded as a result of that click maybe 2 hours later. So you have data coming in at different points. They all are history of the same event, that is, an ad was requested. But what happened for the event could be shifted in time. So if you want to do analysis where you want to combine these all the events into a coherent history or a trace of an event, then you have to bring it together. And lastly, the problem becomes difficult because there are many, many different kind of users for the same system. It starts from, actually I've missed out the developers here, but right from the developers, if they want to get some data for whatever reason, it could be for modeling their forecast engine or for predicting the inventory or etc. It could be normal sales team out there which is trying to kind of do some operational analytics on why my account is not running well or what could I do to make it run better. It could be our analysts who are doing like company level or organization level analysis, direct exit. They want to see a dashboard kind of view every day in the morning. Or it could be other machines. So you could feedback the system into the machine directly and they can query it. So there's a wide spectrum of who the users of this kind of system. So just a little bit about where we started from. So back in like 2010 or before that, we used to get all the data in the logs, just record them on the ad serving machine. And there was a first script which used to run every hour, crunch all the data, put it in the database. And then we had a user interface which would query the database for the report. So it was only canned report, there was no ad hoc. So you had you knew what kind of reports you wanted to show to the users, and you had built database views to do that. And it was perfectly valid model at that time. We had entered the business, the number of dimensions were like hardly few, probably country, publisher, advertiser, operating system was also like not so relevant because all were Nokia or LG kind of phones with Symbian OS or some version of that running. So there were not too many dimensions, there were not too many measures. All you were interested in was how many impressions did I serve and how many clicks I got. And yes, how many requests I received. So the problem was pretty simple. And Perl did it fine. That was about 100,000 or order of 100,000 events per day. Then as the volume increased to millions, the toll process used to just fade over and die, and it can't handle it, it's just full. So we had good developers out there, and they said like, this Hadoop thing is pretty stable, everyone is jumping on it, why don't we try it? So we set up a small cluster, like 3-machine cluster, the data center was somewhere in India. And then we had a small MapReduce job they wrote a small transfer service, which would go and collect logs from all the serving machine, bring it onto the cluster, and then they would run a 3-machine cluster and process it. It would take longer because the cluster was small, but at least it wouldn't die off. It wouldn't, it was still a manageable problem. And things were running fine for a while. But then what happened, like, as the business kept on increasing, people said, I want more views of the data. Just 2 views of the data is not enough. So then the developers had to write more MapReduce jobs to populate the DB. So every time a new requirement came, they had to write a new pipeline MapReduce jobs, which would crunch the logs and populate one of the views in the DB. Now, this was a harder, time-consuming, and also error-prone. It's very hard to get a MapReduce job right. If it is not a very trivial job. So we said, fine, this map reducing is not working for us. Let's solve for the pipeline right now. Ad hoc is still like, so the way we handled ad hoc was creating more views. If you want this kind of report, you have requirement for these 3 dimensions and these 2 measures, fine, it's important. We create another database view on it, materialized view, and we have, we just focus on getting that views right. So we experimented with PIG. PIG worked out very fine for us, like, you could take PIG, simply write a new job, and that would populate your DB views. So, and the data gets aggregated using PIG on an hourly basis, post to DB for analytics, and everyone was happy. PIG again, like, just as a caution, like, if anyone's taking his advice, PIG works fine as long as you have jobs which are just limited to, let's say, group by and sums and few filters. But if you're doing anything more complicated, I mean, exact examples probably I can talk offline, but if you're doing anything more complicated which may involve multiple phases of MapReduce jobs, then PIG turns out to be expensive because writing custom MapReduce jobs gives you a lot more control, and you can actually compress many of the MapReduce phases one after the other into one phase. And with MapReduce jobs or any of these Hadoop based jobs, IO is the biggest killer. So if you can reduce the number of stages in the pipeline, that's going to be a single biggest advantage or use case. Okay, but then the things again change. Now enter tablets and enter Android, and you have like 1,000 different versions of Android, and analytics just gets complicated. New ad formats and introduce rich media or these media ads where you can ask for your queries like, how many users viewed this video from 20th minute to 30th minute? Or how many of them went till half of the video? Or if it's like a car, interactive car ad, you want to get analytics on how many people are actually fiddling around with the steering a lot. So either it could mean that they like the steering a lot, or they're trying to see whether it fits to the knee or something. So you can select all kind of things from the ad itself. It's like building a heat map over an ad, what parts of the ad are interesting to the user, and it's just not about what ad is interesting to the user. So the analytics get much more complicated. As I said earlier, like DB still suffers from the limited view problem. You have like 300 dimensions, you can either look at the DB from this view or that view. So like if you have 300 dimensions, creating 100 three-dimensional views is just not enough. It is it lacks immensely. So we tried different approaches at this time. We took on Hype, that was about late 2010, early 2011. So this was actually a big surprise and a big disappointment. It didn't work out as we expected. At that time, I cannot comment exactly on what is the state right now, but I would be very, very surprised if it is very drastic. So if you have like a layer, so if you think of your infrastructure stack, you have Edgebase or HDFS at the bottom, then you have Hadoop MapReduce built on top of it, and then you have PIG and Hive and all those things over it, and you take it to the extreme where you have things like Pentaho, which will even package everything together and give it to you. Now, what we have noticed from our experience that things at the bottom of the stack are pretty stable. So if you're talking about HDFS or MapReduce from Hadoop, they are pretty stable and you don't need to muck around with them or tinker around with them too much to get them working. Sure, to get a good grid running, if you are maintaining a grid of machines on your own, it takes a little bit of effort to tune the parameters, but it's not that bad. As you keep moving up the stack, the quality of the software available out there drastically reduces. So if it's a query engine like Hive or something, let's take Pig. Pig is, I would say, below Hive in terms of the abstraction it's providing you. It's giving you more, element level operations, load this table, run a group by on it, and do some filtering on it. So it's pretty stable, it does the work. You have to sacrifice a little bit of control, but you can still get the work done. If you come to Hive, you have more assumptions built into it. How a query is going to be planned, what are the operations that are going to be optimized, to what level the optimizations will be done. And these kind of systems, we have noticed that they are not meant or written out to be so that one size fits all. I don't know if it is even possible to do so, but they work very well at Facebook where they were implemented. Similar as Google's implementation, which they haven't open sourced. But they work very well where they were conceived. But outside that environment, there are a lot of challenges. In our case, the particular challenge was the grid size was small. About at that time when we were trying Hive, it was about 20-25 machines. And Hive or any system, I'm not like picking on Hive as a bad system. I'm just saying because that we tried it and what we faced and just shared. So it needs a lot of resources. It'll spawn inordinate number of jobs. It will not try to reduce the data in the mapper stage as well as that can be. So there's a lot of data transfer between mapper and reducer. And if you have low bandwidth system, not by low bandwidth, I mean you have probably a 100 gig or 10 gig kind of connectivity between your machines, it doesn't scale so well. Then inordinate number of jobs is what I told. So for a simple query, it will spawn 5 jobs. So that if you are crunching 100 gigs of data, that same 100 gigs of data would be read and written in a sequence of 5 operations. And that would be very bad for the performance. And since it hurts on multiple levels, if one query is taking all your resources and time, then you can't run any other query. Whereas if you had a 5,000 machine cluster or something bigger than that, superly connected, this would run in some corner of the cluster and you wouldn't even notice all these delays I'm talking about. But when you change the environment in which these systems are supposed to run, you face a lot of problems. The second thing what we faced problems were immensely large code base and very less expertise available within our organization to get it right. It was at that time, it was about 150,000 lines of code or something, 120,000 lines of code, and it's a mess. For any open source system, they work, but you go look at the code, and it's really, really, really hard to just go and change anything or fix anything. If you guys attended this talk by Kulkarni from Google yesterday, the same thing he brought up, why do people still are trying to go and use Google's BigQuery interface or something, even though it's limited, but it takes lesser time. It takes about 6 months to get a Hadoop-based stack right and start doing it, and even then the guarantee is not there that for how long have you got it right. If the there's a high change in your model of the data, maybe you have to just throw it and review it. So we worked on it for about 3-4 months, a team of very bright engineers, three engineers, but it was just turning out to be too hard a problem to crack. So we went back to Pig. We said, Chuck, Hive, you can't spend forever on it. We'll just go back to Pig. It's okay if you're a business user, cannot write Pig script. We put a team of engineers, 10 engineers, 5 engineers, who will take the request from business, and they will write Pig script and give the report back. Now, as you can see, there are multiple problems. First of all, there's a delegation of request. Analyst tells someone finds a bug or something, which comes to the data team or so, that this report is to be given. And then that gets assigned to a developer. He or she writes a Pig script. In many cases or very frequently, what they gave back to the business is not what they wanted, so it's a back and forth. So approximately we saw about 3 to 4 days turnaround time for every query being processed, and one developer day per query being taken to process every query on average. And the second problem was the performance of anything like Pig is only as good as the person writing them. And if the person is not very familiar with the data model or doesn't know the Pig that well, or for whatever reason, then one script can just kill the entire system. And if the system is small, it's easy to get killed. And we had a lot of these issues, like someone wrote a bad BigQuery and the entire web came down, and we had to get in the middle of the night, reboot all the machines or do stuff. So what are the lessons we took at this point? Frequently, tools which are available out there don't work as intended. They require a lot of tweaking, constant tuning, and a lot of maintenance. It's very difficult for them to absorb the dynamics of the data. If your data is changing very, very frequently, then you have to be very careful about what you're using and make sure that that system or the way you are using that system is able to take care of the changes or the variations in the business. You cannot afford to spend 6 months in a system and then with a change of business like Apple introducing iPhone, and suddenly all your data model and everything is a boom and you have to again start from scratch. They're generally we found too generic, so when systems are there out there, they are not meant for a particular person, organization or need. They are like developing databases, so you have our operating system, you make one version, you give it to everyone and everyone will use it. But unfortunately, at this scale, the genericity doesn't work that well. You have to be a little bit specific to your need, and you just can't take off-the-shelf system and get it to work. And I mean, you may be able to get to work if the problem is suited to that, but in most cases and in most conversations I've had with people, it's very difficult and almost impossible to get it right that way. The other part which is actually glaring, and many of you would agree, is there is no end-to-end coherent system available. There are parts of the stack available, developed by different people, different organizations, different time levels. I mean, one could argue that that's the beauty of open source, that everything just comes from everywhere. But when you try to integrate them and put them all together, it's a very, very hard task. You know, if you think about this problem, you would have to take data transfer layer from somewhere else. It could be Stripe or something. Then you would have a scheduler, which is Ruby or Astaban or something else. Then you would have an ETL layer, which could be Pig or custom MapReduce jobs. You would have some data storage format. You would have Hive to run the query. You would have Hue on top of it to build your queries. And then you would have I don't know, Crystal reports or something to visualize the data, and so on. Like the story is endless. Like, I've already touched so many things. You could go with things like Pentaho, which we tried and we are still trying with some section of it. But even there, like things are not as sweet as they appear on the face of it. It takes a lot of effort, and sometimes it just doesn't work. And the last thing I mean, it's obvious, it's not even a realization that Pig is not suited to be used by business. And if we use Pig, if we overfit Pig for all the requirements, that is both the pipelines as well as the ad hoc queries, then it's bad because it would eat up a lot of developer time, which would be used elsewhere to do more meaningful things. So just to give a small example about, these are like, I was talking about complexity to your report. So, I'll come to this tool a little bit later, but what you see is here are dummy data, and these are the dimensions which a person requested for. I couldn't get them to fit on one screen, so I've taken 3 snapshots of the report to just show. There are about like 36 odd dimensions here, and 10 or so measures. So this is one screen, this thing continues on the second screen, and this thing continues on the third screen. So you have like a huge, huge horizontal report, and this is a like one of the reports which I noted this morning, so I thought I'll just share it. You have reports even bigger than that. So how do you even start by building database views, or even if you take specialized commercial $1 million software, how do you get this report to work there where you have like 37, 38 dimensions and I don't know, so many measures? And it just gets killed. Like, forget about answering this query in 1 hour or 2 hours. Most of the system will not be able to answer it if they don't know a priori what the requirement is going to be or what the pattern of the report is going to be. Okay, so I was saving last 15 minutes for the demo. I'll quickly rush through what we have, and I'll probably let the product itself describe itself. So I'll just go very quickly through what is this. So we developed Yoda, which you can think of it as in the same space of the stack as Hive. It does many things similar to Hive. We even borrowed from Hive where we thought we could doesn't make any sense to implement again, like RC file format, which is a beautiful file format to save records and query on. So it's an in-house developed query system to perform completely ad hoc analysis. It's a complete stack. It's not one part of the entire end-to-end stack. This has ETL, a query processor, a query builder. So visually you can build a query, a visualization layer on top of it. And this is all built on top of Hadoop. It supports your usual operators like every other SQL compliant DB does. A lot lesser than that, but most of the important ones like select, sum, average, distinct, expressions, go by, where, having, user-defined functions, adding. Where it differs slightly is very, very heavily optimized for storage and queries, considering a data model which is lying underneath it. So it makes use of the data model in every way possible. I'll come to it a little bit later and give few examples of it. But it tries to use the data model very, very extensively and optimize the queries. All the facts, be it time-shifted facts, what I talked about, or we have about 100 different metadata tables where you would have ID to name mapping or something like this. But they all are just brought together in a seamless view and given to the user so that the user doesn't have to worry about what table should this query go to and what are the joins I need to do for them. Like I'll come to the demo. It's very, very simplistic. And it's exposed as a platform, so there's a UI, user interface, as well as an API interface to it. So it can be plugged in like Peg or Hive into other systems, and other systems can directly query and consume that. So instead of going through the whole design of it, I'll just have a little slide called Life of Query. I'll just walk through how, when a query comes, what stages it goes through on a very, very high level view, and finally what happens. So we use a protocol buffer from Google extensively, both to store the data and also for communication between systems. It's a very, very beautiful technology given by Google, and I encourage you guys to take a look at it. It'll solve a lot of problems. It appears to be a very tiny thing in the whole of the big picture, but it solves a lot of problems. So you have a UI which generates a request in this system's format and transmits it to the server in JSON format. The first level is where we do some optimization. The first level of optimization we did was whatever is required from the metadata table. So there are two parts of any data warehousing system. There are fact streams which keep coming from log servers or where the actual action is happening. And then there is slowly changing metadata where you keep record of small IDs to larger names or other attributes. So when you query on dimensional attributes which come from metadata, then it requires us to do a join. Joins are expensive, so if we can cut down the joins very early in the query life cycle, it'll help us a lot. So we do metadata to fact promotions by converting all these group by into decode. So if it was a group by, let's say, country, the group by country. So that would require a join from country ID to country name. But I could do a decode. A decode is like a if-then clause in SQL where you can say if the value is equal to 2, then emit India. So if you convert these group bys into decode, then you don't need to do a join on the metadata. Similarly for the where. After the optimizations are done, we automatically select a cube. So you have multiple data cubes lying underneath, all on flat files. I haven't gone into that. So we automatically select the cube depending on the user query instead of user specifying what cube or they should go to. And also an appropriate level of granularity or aggregation over it, which will answer the query in the least time. After this is done, we create these join chains, what we call, which will help in the metadata-based dimensional queries. And we also estimate the cost of the query and priority, and then submit it to the job tracker. So this helps in segregating small queries and large queries. A large query cannot come and just take over the entire system and everyone else has to wait. So this is a very, very important part of it. If not for this, then one user could affect the entire organization. Once it's done, we reformulate the query a little bit again to remove the redundancies. Like if you have asked for a particular measure, like let's say valid add request has four columns, one as part of no-fill rate and another part of calculating some other formula of yours, then we try to remove redundancy and optimize the query. Once it's done in the mapper, you have like a lot of optimization, filter push down. So when you're doing a filter over a record, while we are reconstructing the record from the disk, we keep applying filters, and as soon as we figure out that this record cannot pass through, we just drop the reconstruction stage for that record. So it helps us bring a lot less data out from the disk into the memory. And after that, we do aggregations in the mapper. So this is also very important. We do a lot of aggregation right in the map side instead of waiting all the way to the reduce. So this helps us transfer a lot less data from mapper to reducer, which is good for a system where you don't have a huge amount of bandwidth. In the reducer, it's pretty simple. We just apply the formula which the user has given. The formula being no fill rate or CTR or something. Perform a having clause. If the query has a having clause, do it. And then do a top end. If the user has, I want to see only top end countries, something like that. And once it's done, you dump the file into a CSV format and send a link to the user and also make it visible on the UI, which will come to in a minute. Okay, so two slides on what, out of all this, what I've described, what are the two or three things which really work for us? The first thing was I concentrate really high on efficiency of the system and modeling of the data. So if the data is modeled correctly, then it can handle dynamicity in the data. It can handle a lot of new fields coming in, and you don't have to stop the system or redo it. Like the system what we have takes in new fields into the model. I mean, without blinking, no one even feels that there was anything. Then we have done a lot of work on optimizing the joins. Joins are the killer thing in any of the data warehousing system built over MapReduce. Every join or a group by requires one map to reduce space, and if you have a lot of them, like many of the tools available out there have, then the time increases drastically. So what we have done is we have optimized the map size joins very, very heavily. We load only what is required into the memory and filtered by many different criteria, horizontally, vertically, and also filtered based on what user has given. So that helps us load. If you're familiar with high map size joins, you would know that this map size joins are applicable to small tables. Now, small is not defined. Small depends from machine to machine, environment to environment. But what is written in the documentation is that about 10 or 20 MB tables are considered small tables with under 100,000 rows or something. After that, it becomes big. But with these kind of optimizations, we can load tables of up to 5 million rows into memory. I mean, we don't load all the 5 million rows because we do a lot of filtering. And the table size could be, I mean, as big as about 400 or 500 MB. So it's a huge scale. And then the other neat technique we have done is like when you are joining these fact tables with a dimension and you have a billion fact rows, you don't need to do the join every time. You could pre-compute these joins, keep it in the memory, and then reuse those pre-joins to even speed up the query. Simplicity. So we'll come to the demo in one more minute. Like, if the system is not simple, then it will not get used. People will not use it, and it'll be just another technical showcase kind of system which you are building in the company and will be there. It should be ability to store log data dynamics. It should be very, very intuitive when you are building the queries, and a good analytics there on top of it. We were there up to some time, but we realized just dumping the CSV file or an Excel file out to the user is not necessary enough in every case. Like, you need to have something more rich than that. And then again, like in the beginning I had said, the difference between ad hoc and canned query is very, let's say, shaky. So you should be able to support scheduled ad hoc queries. So once the user thinks that this ad hoc query is not ad hoc anymore, they can just go and schedule it and it runs for them to your thing. So that's all in the slide. I'll jump into the demo of it. And while I'm going, if you have any questions, like, I'll be happy.
Just wanted to know, what is the aggregation ratio you have on your, for example, the 26 between the view? Just wanted to know, what is the aggregation ratio you get? Like, what is the input by input loss by output record finally stored in the view? And for example, the dimension.
So, I mean, it varies. So we have multiple queues. We have like queues which we have anticipated to be used very, very frequently. So there probably from 3 million records, they would come to 3 million records. And then we have increasingly more complex queues where the aggregation ratio wouldn't be that great. So, I mean, approximately to the largest queue which we keep at the aggregated layer, it would be probably from 3 billion to maybe about 50 million rows. So response time varies. Actually, the fastest we can get here is not less than about 45 seconds. It takes so much of time to just start MapReduce and get a ticket. But like the bad queries actually can be pretty bad. So they can go up to half an hour or something. even 45 minutes, even up to 5 hours. But most 90% of inquiries come back within 2 minutes.
Can you give an example? So in the beginning you mentioned that it's hard to generalize at that scale, right?
Yes.
Can you give examples of things that somebody who was building a generic system would not have known, and hence you were able to optimize for those scenarios rather than somebody in a generic system?
So let's say just loading the metadata tables into the memory. So that is one example. Now what happens in all the generic system is you can partition them horizontally and vertically, but you still don't know what else you can leave out. And that's the reason why it's very difficult to optimize that. But take our example where we are, let's say, connecting the events that happened to the creative. What was the creative name and the creative, by creative I mean advertisement. What is the advertisement name and the advertisement type for which this impression happened? And I want to do it for last 1 month of the data. So if I store in the metadata table what is the creation date for this creative, then I can afford not to load all those creatives into the memory which were lying outside this 1 month range. So that helps us bring, or that gives us more confidence that the system can keep on handling more and more and more data, and we bring it only in the memory what is required and just leave out of the disk. So that was just one example.
Do you have plans to make
Yes, we are actually in talks to do it. There are a couple of things like we want to be sure before we make it open source. Like there are some, like I just said, this is slightly customized to our data model. We don't want to just throw out there what is what makes sense only to us and not to others. So we have to take it out of the system and expose it at as interfaces that if you want to realize these potentials, then you get this data in, your data into this format. And then be able to exploit these potentials. And the second thing is we are lack of people to do our work. Like it's a very, very tight situation. So to make a good system, document it, and make it usable by others, it takes some amount of effort. Then there's also a thought in where to open source it. We can open source the system as it is, or we can break it apart. There are many parts like automatically selecting the queue, which is like a Mondrian kind of system which you can integrate with Edge catalog. And the query operators and better joins you could give back to Hive. So you could either break the system apart and contribute to multiple systems so users don't have to have familiarity with yet another system, or the easier way would be just to clean it up and give it up. So we are still thinking what the best way to do it. Yes? Yes, you know, data doesn't come in form of JSON. Like we add serving records it in the form of JSON just because they want to read it out, like to run grep queries on it. JSON is very, very temporary format. It's like 1 day lived format. After that, we store everything into protocol buffer for the system. We don't store anything in JSON. Yes.
Estimate the cost of the query before
splitting that. Yeah, it's basically a heuristic. You can call it a little bit of black magic. Like. What you do is like there are two parts of it, how many dimensions and measures have you requested for, and then what is the complexity of the queue it is going to, and the third part is for how long have you queried. So some mixture of these three attributes tell you what the cost of query is. So this is like a front page when the user logs in. Now if you see here, this is an empty space, and they, here you have a list of all the fields, they are grouped together. So there's no concept of what cube you want to go to or do what. All you do is like you dive in. I want to see number of clicks. So these are dummy data. This is only for representation purpose here, because the feedback we got was when you're building the query, many times you realize a mistake later on that this is not what you wanted. And if you present a visual structure of the query to them, then it becomes a lot more intuitive there. So you select, like let's say I just want two measures and I want to group it down by country, and I want to group it down by timestamp, and from timestamp I will take date wise, and I could have dragged filters here. So if I put country here, I should get country. So you could add multiple countries or something and submit. You can have multiple filter conditions. I'll just remove it and you can say run. So you can, at this time you can do three things. Either you can run it, or you can schedule it for periodic runs, or you could just save it for as a template query for later. And once you're here, you just select for what date range or dot duration of the data you want to run it, and you say submit. So it's submitted. Now if you go come to the running portion, like I can see a lot more queries. So this query is run currently running by someone else. It's a bad query, like not a bad but a long query. Mine just got submitted. So let's see how the data time has been looking for. So I wouldn't like pull up the data for this query. I have prepared a query to show here. That is for 1 year old data, and there's some anonymization of data and like fabrication of data not to give out the actual numbers. But you see like the query times here. So like 1 minute, 1 minute 17, 2 minute, under 1 minute, 2 minute, 4 minutes, 44 seconds, 57. So in general, the query times are pretty fast. For the queries that matter to people, it's very, very fast. So I'll just pull up one query which I ran earlier in the day. Yes. So what you can do with this query is you can either go and download this thing, you can see my mouse here, or you can rerun the query. Or these are the two kind of, we are just starting with the visual analytics tool, but these are the two tools. This is a simple one, which will, you can both of them together, they are going to pull data. So this tool will just pull all the data from the report and show it to you. So you can do filtering and sorting and all sorts of things here. You can like sort it down, up or down. So, but this, like you can see, like the data is so much, it's hard to make sense out of it. Probably you would be downloading into Excel and doing something more with it. So to overcome that, we have like this another tool. So this is like the same data in a chart way, which this should be exciting. So, okay, so what I requested for 31 days of data for 16 countries of 7 operating systems, and these were some as good references. Now I want to start getting the sense of the data, and the three measures I wanted were the add request, impressions, and clicks. So the first thing I want to see is how's my business doing across time, and I want to see it on a line chart. Okay, so you can see here very quickly how your business has been doing. There was some drop here, which we tried to see what constituted this drop, but there was a drop here, we want to know why. So we just keep the chart here, we'll do a drill down. So the entire thing has moved back, you can come back to it. And I want to see the same thing by country, that whether one particular country has been doing this or is it for every country. So I'll draw it again. Okay, so this is interesting. So this red thing here, which is India, so this was for July last year and very like restricted data. So India suddenly dropped it about 10th July kind of thing and virtually became non-existent. Whereas this one is Thailand, even Thailand dropped. So I can see that this pattern is the drop in the revenue, sorry, impressions which I saw earlier was because of India and Thailand. So before I go further into it, like I just want to see how is the relative impression distribution between these countries for impressions and clicks. Let's say I just take clicks, and at this time I want pie chart. Okay. So this is again interesting. I can see that Thailand has the maximum share of impressions as clicks. So I would probably want to go and check Thailand further, because Thailand is the important country and it also led to a drop. India comes second in the number, and we also would want to see why it is a drop. Now, but this thing you see here, if this is even interesting, the inner pie is clicks and the outer pie is impressions. So India is giving you on an average many more clicks as compared to impressions, whereas if you take this country which is Indonesia, it is giving a lot of impressions, the green pie, but the inner pie click is less. But this was just one of them. I want to see why that dip happened in my entire business. So I've selected Thailand here, you can see Thailand, and I just drill down. So now all my charting is restricted to only Thailand. So let's say I want to check across operating system impressions and how are they contributing and what happened to them. Take a chart this time, let's say. So, this was not good, sorry. Okay, so this is giving a much better picture. I can see that Symbian OS is giving a lot of impressions only in Thailand, then Nokia, then others. And if I want to see how they are contributing across time, then what I need to do is I select time and operating system. Just one moment. So here like things become a lot clearer. Your Symbian OS suddenly had dropped. It didn't pick up much after that. And this one, whoever this guy was, like others we don't recognize, these two had dropped, which had led to a drop in sessions. So these are the kind of things you can do. Now just one last thing, let's say you wanted to repeat this entire thing instead of filing for India. So all you need to do is like select India here and say update, and it'll just go all the way up and do all these things on top. So you could do a lot of things you can do. Ultimately, you could export these things which people do, and like they can export them as charts here and embed it in their PowerPoint and send it out to customers, do whatever. Okay, thank you.